Hi guys. Thank you for coming out on this Sunday morning. Okay, my name's Mo. I'm from New Zealand. This is very hot weather. Why am I wearing a jacket?
Take it off.
You know, that's a very good first question to get from the audience.
Take it off.
You know, usually I start these out asking questions of my own. If you guys go ahead and just start lining up here at the microphone.
I said once, Joe Manganiello is going to play Slade Wilson Deathstroke. Then I'm going to do Magic Mike.
So Magic Mike 3, Magic Mike Triple XL, or whatever they're going to call it. We got to get more than one person to the microphone. A couple of people.
Oh yeah, let's do some Q&A.
Yeah, let's do some Q&A. Let's do some Q&A.
Yeah. What you got, Don?
What's your name?
I'm nervous.
Hi,
I'm Dawn.
Dawn, you shouldn't be nervous.
Not a sucker. I don't be nervous. So when I play gritty stuff, you know, when I have to say something with conviction, those layers underneath that have, you know, I mean, Slade Wilson had it, Crixus had it, you know, I have these opportunities with these roles to bring out that tone. You know, it's like playing classical piano, you know. It's like, you know, hit those big, dark, heavy notes. You gotta go there, you know, you gotta find that place. So anyway, so I got in there and you know, there was these young guys, I'm Spartacus, and of course she said to Mamu, they're looking for like 20-year-olds. And at the time I was like 38, you know, and she went, yeah, you're too old. And I was like, oh, where do I go? She goes, yeah, well, just put yourself on tape anyway, just, you know, do whatever you gotta do. I was like, and really I was just going like, oh, bullshit. Sorry. But I remember just being kind of annoyed, and I looked at the camera and I went, you know, da 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 da. Thank you. I walked off. And you know, maybe it was a month later or something, she rang up, she said, Manu! And I'm like, Manu, they like your audition that you did for Spartacus. And I went, oh, she told me I was too old. I went, oh, no, well, you know, they're looking for different people. Anyway, she said, oh, they want you to go and they want you to read for a different character, Animaeus. How many people want Spartacus here? I don't know. Oh, okay. So Animaeus, you know, the Peter Mensa guy, right? So I go in and I'm like, what is beneath your feet? And of course I didn't get that role, because Peter Mensa does that line so much better. Another few weeks went past, and you know, she rang up and she goes, oh, Manu, you didn't get that role. And I was like, ooh. And then they said, oh, and she rang up and she goes, oh, they want you to come in and read for another role, for the role of Barker. I remember one scene. I remember the first scene that I ever did with the guy that plays Barker, right? And you know, he came out, and the two of us were coming out as gladiators. Or being, it was the very first scene you ever saw me, and you saw the Beast of Carthage, you know, Barker, and we were paraded in the middle of the Romans, in the middle of this, you know, wild Roman party that was going on. Notice how I used the other word. It's the kids. So we walked in, and I remember thinking, like, how am I going to act as a gladiator? You know? As I walked in, I just went in and I stood there like this, and I just went, you know, it's not acting, it's just acting tough. And I looked sideways, and Antonio Tamayo was like this, smelling his armpits. This thing at these girls. God, how come I don't make choices like this? But anyway, so of course I didn't get Barker either, because I couldn't do the armpits and thing. But on that particular role, it went to the point where they were going to fly me to America. And I was like, they said, they're going to fly you over to a screen test. And they rang up the day before I was about to fly. And I said, Manu, they're not going to fly you to America now. They're giving the role to somebody in New Zealand. I was like, oh. I mean, I, and I was on the building site, and I was digging this hole in the backyard of this house that I've got a little swimming pool in. My manager was ringing up, she was like, "Mano, are you still in the hole?" I was like, yeah, it's getting deeper. And then she went, and then, you know, then she rang up for a couple of weeks later, she said, Manu, they want to see you for another role, but I don't know how to pronounce this name. You know, it was because it was C-R-I-X-U-S, you know. I remember at the read-through, the first table read-through that we did, and I hadn't even really heard it said by anybody else. And it got to Peter Mensa, where he was calling my character out onto the floor, you know, onto the arena, onto the training ground. And we were reading the script, and it got round, and it got to Peter Mensa, and he went, "Cretius!" And I went, "Oh, I hope it's not Cretius." It sounds like something you'd spray in your ironing pile. Classic Cretius. No more Cretius. Anyway, so I got called in for this role of Crixus, you know, and I went back to Faith Martin's studio. But that particular morning, you know, I decided that I'd go and swim and really center myself, really get myself as focused as I could possibly be, and as calm as I could be, so that I'd be able to just let it all out in control. So then I arrived and I felt really great, and I walked into the Faith Martin studio, and there was nobody there. And I looked at my watch, and it was like a couple of minutes until I'm going to be doing my audition. And because of the time that my audition was meant to be happening, and there was nobody there, I started to do some push-ups, and I was going, okay, I'm not losing it, I'm centered. 10 minutes later, nobody's there. Yeah, this is, okay, wait up, I'm starting to get a headache. And all of a sudden, Faith Martin walks out. She goes, "Manu, what are you doing here?" And I said, "Faith, I'm here for my screen test for Crixus." He said, "Manu, you better go ring your agent. They were negotiating your terms, and the producers got really miffed, got beat off because of some negotiation that your agent was pushing for, and they cancelled your audition. They're not going to see you." I mean, everything just sort of, it was like this domino effect. And I asked really, and then she said, "Mommy, I'm sorry, I've got something else I've got to do right now. You need to go." And I walked out. And I went walking past the big sports stadium that was there. I remember walking past this giant. I rang my agent and I got through her and I said, "Ruth, what happened?" And she went, "Manu, I'm so sorry. I don't know what happened. We were trying to get you residuals." You know, because, kid, if you ever do a movie and somebody's going to watch it on Netflix, you should be paid for it. They're still watching your show. So she said, "Manu, I'll do what I can." And I hung up and I kept on walking. And I must have been 3 kilometers from Faith Martin's studio when the phone rings. And she goes, "Manu, where are you?" And I said, "Oh, Faith, I'm almost home." She said, "You have to be here in 5 minutes. You have to get here. I have to film you in 5 minutes. I've only got a couple of minutes to do this, okay? So just run back here now, okay? Just get back here." And it was a really saturated with sweat, just desperate, like, well, you know, just out of my mind. Was, you'll know about this kid in front of me, he's a black belt. What happens in that moment when you gotta do it? Yeah, you gotta get up, you gotta get it all up, and you gotta just center yourself. I swear, there's never been a moment in my life that was more critical than that. 5 seconds before she said, when she said, "Manu, are you ready?" White sweat on my face, heart pounding, mind spinning. Took a big deep breath and I went, "Shall I begin?" You know, and, oh man, I swear, every moment, every bit of anything that ever happened to me just went boom. And the moment that I finished that audition, I just went, this role is mine. I know that if ever I've acted, I just did it right there and then, you know. And I walked out and something, a light had gone off, you know, a real light had gone off, or gone on. And, but still, it was like 2 months later that I'm sitting in this bird aviary. I'm sitting in a bird aviary at this place called Taronga Zoo. I just had my first little girl. My daughter was in a pram. And I was actually sitting there thinking like, how am I going to feed this baby? You know? Because I hadn't heard back. So I'd started to think like, oh, that wonderful feeling you had when you left that audition. Well, that was just a wonderful feeling. I'm pushing the pram, just listening to these birds. My name means Manu, by the way. This was such a symbolic moment. All these birds are angry. And the producer, this is one of the things that maybe people won't know, but who knew that I was in Xena, Warrior Princess? Okay, so 10 years before, I did an episode of Xena, Warrior Princess with Lucy Lawless, you know, who ended up playing Domina in Spartacus, you know, Lucretia. And she, her husband, who was the producer of Xena, New Zealand.
Rob Tappert.
He ended up being the producer of, he was the producer of Spartacus. Him and an old school friend of his had come up with it when they were in university, that one day they would get together. And his school friend, Bill Hamm, had just become the CEO of Starz Network. So he had suddenly he was in a position to pull the strings, you know what I mean? And so he'd run up Rob and said, oh, you know, I'm the head honcho at Starz. And Rob had gone like, well, what about that idea we talked about back in university days about doing Spartacus together? And that's how that idea was born. And then when they started thinking about the characters, you know, and I'd gone for certain characters, and it was Rob who was actually sort of saying, oh, we should see this guy, you know. So anyway, it was him on the phone. And he went, Manu? He calls me Manu, he's from Texas. It's Manu. He went, Manu?
Hey, I'm from Texas, and I can say it the right way.
Yeah, well, thank you.
What can I say?
You can probably educate Osh instead. Rob is one of the smartest he's ever done. He's bought so much work to New Zealand, and I owe that guy for my career. He gave me 30 days of money, Josh Arkin as well. That guy has helped me have the career that I've got. But anyway, he was, Manu, it's Rob Tappert. And I went, oh, hi, Rob. Hey. And he went, Manu, I'm the producer on Spartacus. And I went, oh. And he went, Manu, listen. We've all been watching your audition, and we really like what you did, but unfortunately, I can't offer you the role. I said, what are you calling for? this is just the last hit. And I said, yeah, okay. He said, well, man, I can't offer you the role, because what had happened in Xena, is we'd had like 10 years beforehand. I played Mark Antony, and I had this fight against these Romans. And when I'd done it, when I'd done the fight, I'd gone into the stunt guys and I'd gone, hey guys, these swords are made of rubber. And I went, yeah, yeah. I said, well, instead of going like, they're missing each other, like, you know, because you can sort of see on. At that point on Xena, I don't know whether I'd really seen a fight that looked like something that ended up looking the way it did on Spartacus. So I said, listen, why don't we just hit each other? So we went into this fight scene, and I was like, bang, and I was whacking this guy right across his chest, or, you know, stabbing the guy and bleeding him in the gut and stuff like that. And there was this the safety woman on set who was going like, stop. And we're in the middle of this big fight scene. She goes, you can't do that. Stop doing that. And we're like, oh, okay. We might not get any easier. Anyway, so that was on Xena 10 years beforehand. And Rob went, man, we can't offer you the role unless you promise not to hurt Al Spartacus. I said, what do you mean, Rob? He says, well, you remember back in Xena? You're a bit crazy with the swords. I was like, Rob, I promise. I hit Andy Whitfield and all those other gladiators so much. And you know, yeah, I mean, really, I broke that promise so many times. Because that was one of the great things about Spartacus. We all trained so hard, so, you know, we all knew each other's movements so well that we could go within an inch of hitting each other, and sometimes we would hit each other, you know. And then when I promised, Rob said these words. He said, Manu, welcome to Spartacus.
Hello, Manu. My name is Ken.
Hey, Ken.
Speaking of another fight on set, Condemned, I read something that you and Stone Cold had a little scuffle. Could you explain about that?
Wait. A scuffle with Stone Cold Steve Austin?
A scuffle with Stone Cold Steve Austin. Okay, here we go. Actually, there was two scuffles. The first one was with John Cena. Okay. This happened, right? So one of my very first acting jobs, it was actually before Spartacus. It's why I ended up getting the Smashing Machine thing, because of these. I did two films for WWE. The first one that I landed was with John Cena called Marine. And we were in a fight scene, and John had the move of going like this with his arm as I came down, like with a hammer fist this way. And I was hitting him with the inside part of my arm, and he was sort of doing this, and then he threw a hook. And we did it a whole bunch of times, we'll try and keep up our energy and go there. And then suddenly he went in for his hook, and he smacked me right in the face as hard as he possibly could. It was a great John Cena hook that sent me reeling onto the ground. And as I landed, the cameraman was right there, and I was kind of like, this is going to be a good shot. So I got smacked right in the jaw by John Cena. A good knock. It was a good one. I had to go to the hospital. But not because of that, because of my forearm. My forearm blew up purple because of him blocking it with the bone, the soft tissue against bone. About a year or so later, and this was a funny situation, because I was at the gym, and my friend in the gym, who was an actor as well, he said, have you gone in to read the WWE movie? And I went, oh, they're doing another one. And he said, yeah, like, well, there's a big casting call today, the Faith Martins. I said, no, I don't know about that. So I rang up my agent, and I said, the WWE doing another movie? She said, yeah, but you've done one with them already. Things can slip through the cracks unless you're there ready to go. Come on. So I said, well, you know, it's a different type of character, you know. And anyway, so she rang them, and they said they'd see me for this Parker, you know, for this Mexican guy. And I went in and said, con el puño lo voy a matar. Which means I'm going to beat you to death or something like this, with my fist. That was the line that I had to do in the audition. And anyway, so I got the role. And getting to your question about Stone Cold, right? So we were shooting on this island. It was a volcanic island. And this is the moment where I come up out of the water, and I've got my chains, and I run up the rocks, and I get up, and I come around this huge boulder, and as I get around, who's there? Stone Cold Steve Austin. And he throws a punch, and I throw a punch, and I do a big hook at him, okay? That's the first thing, is I do this giant hook at him. As I came around the rock the first time he was there, I like it was like volcanic rocks, and you really had to watch your footing. And I sort of grabbed my feet on the rocks, and I held it, wow. And then they said, oh, they were cut. Manu, your punch is like, we can see the distance between your fist and his face. It's missing him by too big a margin. You need to get to a position where it's coming over his shoulder, his head's here. You've got to be able to come around there so when he turns his head, you know, the whole thing, you've got to sell this shot, right? And so I said, okay, so I ran up again, came around the corner, Stone Cold Steve Austin, head. Closer. I said, guys, I felt the wind on his nose. And they went, Manu, it's not selling. You've got to come around. I said, Stone Cold is the first day of shooting. I said, Stone's cold. Knows what. Don't worry, you're not going to hit him.
That sounds prophetic.
So around the boulder is exactly what they said. Came out around the corner, launched, went woof, and it was straight in the corner of his eye. I mean, boys who've ever been in a fight, you know that one that lands and it sounds like an apple crunching. And it was just, oh, and Stone Cold went down. I'm sorry, I shouldn't say that, they're kind of bragging rights, but it was kind of like Stone Cold went down. My nephew's on the side of the thing on the set, going like, ah, they're all gonna die. Kill us.
And you're like, my career's gonna die.
I knew at that moment that this was, that was a big, it was, and he went down, and there was blood coming down, and split his eye. And the next morning, he came down to breakfast and like had sunglasses on, and like the whole thing just went purple. And they had to apply, makeup. If you watch The Condemned, watch the scene where he jumps out of the helicopter and comes up on the beach, and you'll see the makeup has started to run off. You can see it. Nobody really does, but that happened. And then what really irked me the most about how that story picked on us. Is that on the video for The Condemned, in the background scenes on these special scenes, there's an outtake, there's an interview with the stunt coordinator. And the stunt coordinator is going, oh yeah, we had one incident on set where an inexperienced actor, he said those words, and I was like, mother, there's my mummy. Stone Cold, yeah.
Well, how does Stone Cold take it? Did he hold a grudge?
No.
Because that's a guy you don't want a grudge from.
No. Stone Cold's boy is such a gentleman. I mean, such a really, it's funny because, both him and John Cena, but John Cena's actually very, he's yes sir, yes sir. But Stone Cold's exactly the same way, There's only one time, when you saw him in the public where, I think it probably goes for Maniac, where you're really in the heat of attention. That he sort of, rears up a bit and sort of just plays, Stone Cold, like this. But the rest of the time, he's actually very funny, and he sort of leads conversation with humor. And lovely guy.
Thank you.
Yeah, no worries, brother. No worries.
All right, so Crixus was my absolute favorite character as far as, that story arc for Crixus, being the top dog and then the rivalry between Spartacus and then later friendship. When Andy passed away, I was really concerned that the show was just going to fall off, to get the new actor and like that. But everybody around that new actor did such a good job. How was that for the crew, including yourself? Because you and Spartacus, your storylines are intertwined. You guys are probably the closest.
Can I add into this? Were you as a cast talking about this? Were you all kind of individually facing it, talking through your representatives?
To be honest, nobody knew that Andy was in as much trouble as he was with the cancer. He was very private about it. He took trips to India and he did a couple of things, trying to find alternative ways as well. And nobody really knew about it. Nobody was really saw Andy, and he was there with his wife Vashti, and I almost went up and wanted to congratulate him because I'd heard he'd, you know, been in remission and was getting along, you know, better. And when I looked at him, I rang my producer the next day and I said, "Is Andy okay?" And she said, "I mean, mine was, you know, they had, how do you know?" And I said, "Well, like, I don't know. I just saw him." She said, "Well, you know, it's just been discovered that it's come back again." And at that point, we just thought that there'd be more treatment for him and stuff like that. We're actually filming on set one day, and they stopped production. At that time, like during the whole production of Spartacus, we kept on thinking that we weren't going to be renewed anyway. During our first season of Spartacus, we got slammed by critics. I mean, slammed. You know, they said we were a terrible show, too graphic, too. We were expected to be cancelled, and this particular day when they called us all, well, we expected to go to this. We're going to meet with Paul Grinder, one of our producers, and we expected him to tell us that the show had been cancelled. Except we got there and he said, there's this huge vacuum that it was unbelievable. You know, I've never heard anywhere go so silent, and everyone sort of walked into their own space and kind of had a think about Andy. One of the greatest things that we ever did is a tribute to Andy, and it was never shown up. There's one video that social media that, you know, we sent to Andy when he went in for his first chemo treatment, and it was Barker and myself and a group of the other gladiators. We did this haka. Barker led it because he was a Maori, but I don't do it as well as Antonio. Antonio's a real Maori in language and everything. But he came out and he led this haka. We sent it to Andy. After Andy passed, we did one. Played at the funeral in Australia, hotel in Australia, and it was only played on screen in the church in Australia. But it was everybody from the production, and we were all on the training square. All the women were up on the balcony, with a dolman, one of those guys used to stand, and all the men were down on the training square. And I had the honor to lead it, It was incredible, the energy in that particular thing, the amount of collective emotion that went into that performance, to that recognition of the man, anyway, that's that.
Well, thank you. You guys made a fantastic show.
Thank you. I did a voice on American Dad.
Definitely too young for
probably
too.
Yeah, but I just went, "You gotta jump more wood."
So the ones that maybe you're sharing a lot of scenes with, that you're hanging out with.
Yeah, I mean the girl who played Shadow, on Arrow, her and most scenes where the rain gets into your bones and you get chills. And, I mean, yeah, it's fun as well. You know, it's a lot of fun. But you know, there's always such a huge group of people around you. I like to be part of the umbrella in a series now. I think as a young actor, you usually go in there and you go, it's about me, it's about me. You know, this kind of a thing. You know, I'm becoming a veteran now of this sort of industry, and I love to be able to get onto the set and say hello to the DOP, the camera operators, the sound guys, the guys running around who are going to make you coffee, you know, and just really understanding that the machine is made up of a lot of people and a lot of friends. You get open yourself up to it. You know, some people shut themselves off to it, and maybe that's, you know, maybe that's just their way. There's no right or wrong. But you know, I find that my enjoyment in production is now actually being part of production. The friend you sort of call everybody, you know. Then you kind of, you know, when you get to the end of it, you know, you all really work together and you understood each person's role and you credited them for their role, and I'll give you feedback as well, and that's what friendship is, you know. So you know, I like to broaden my friendship circle as much as I can. Part of doing conventions is kind of, you know, that wonderful opportunity as well, you know, to meet people and just be, I don't know, somehow holding hands in a large and growing circle, you know.
Well, something that I'd offer to her is, you may be too young for Spartacus, but you're definitely not too young for Zena. Zena's fine.
Not my episode.
Lucy Lawless was her first crush, actually. And,
okay, then Zena is definitely perfect for her.
I'm a horrible parent.
It's my second time watching.
She's kind of wacky about Crimson
Side. Moral support? I just threw your daughter under the bus.
We're just about right at time, but I think we give both of you. Go for it.
Oh, yeah.
Probably I'm even more sparring because this one loves Arrow. They love all the superhero series. It's kind of a family tradition to do it. So given that probably we will not have any more Deathstroke, can you put on the mask and say one last,
hey, kid? Of course I can.
Got the mask right here.
Gabby,
get up
here. We need the kid. Come on,
Gabby. Gabby,
come on.
I got one. Yeah, this is the part where you get your phones out. If your phones aren't out, you're doing it wrong. All right, hold on. Everybody ready? Everybody ready?
I don't know whether I can call you. Here. I forget. Hey, kid. I'll be back. Expectations that can give you sleepless nights. You know, as an actor, I know how vulnerable it is digging holes in the backs of houses. But if you worry too much, it can be very stressful. You know, I just, you know, I as an artist, I just take each role that comes along as an opportunity to, I don't know, put my truest feelings, my the energy that I have, you know, I, I often refer to acting like piano playing. I love to play the piano, you know. And there's a moment where if you can just get on those keys and find your space and forget that there's an audience and just feel it. And when you come out of that space, people give you a round of applause or they go, nice, beautiful, that touched me and stuff like that. And then you understand what art is about. And for me, it's just to know that the next opportunity I get, that I'm able to do that, you know, just to relax and not have to, you know, as I said, you know, when you're a young actor, you're very conscious about yourself, you're nervous, and a lot of things get in the way of your art. As you get older, you realize you kind of just need to just let all that go and get there and do a good job. So for me, it's not so much about the character that the role will be about. It's about the ability to let go and share, give freely, and then find out what happens. You know? And that could be a historic character, that could be a cultural character, that could be being dressed up as a woman. I don't know. But if it makes sense and you can make that emotional connection with the audience, just do your job. That's all that matters. So who knows? It's a mask with a question mark on it. But you know, when I give it to me, I'll put it on, I'll do my best. Yeah.
I've just got I'm going to ask a favor of you in the audience. We have a really wonderful crew that's been keeping the show running really wonderfully all weekend. Can we get a round of applause for the crew? And I especially appreciate guys like yourself that all of us love so much, who swings in, at the last minute to join us as a surprise. And I think I speak for all of us. One of the more delightful surprises of the weekend, suddenly my Bennett's here to make it for you. Thank you.